I'd like to give honor to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ this morning. I'd like to give honor to the pastor. I'd like to give honor to my fellow ministers in the house and my friends. It's truly an honor to be here once again. And for those who are in social media, we say good morning to you as well.
Amen.
Now, for the sake of time, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask if you would turn with me to the fourth chapter of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4. And when you have found it, I'm going to ask if you all would stand in reverence to the reading of God's Word, Ephesians chapter 4. And we're just going to read the first 7 verses together. Amen?
Amen.
And it reads as follows. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with longsuffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure, the gift of Christ. Father God, we come to you in this beautiful day, in the blessed name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you so much for giving us a place to come and worship.
Yes.
Father God, we thank you so much for allowing us to come out here in open and public and not having to sneak and cry.
Yes.
Father God, we just ask right now in the name of Jesus that your word would go forth this morning. Draw the sinner unto you. Draw the backslider unto you. This day, in the blessed name of Jesus, let your word go out beyond the walls of this building. And bring the lost to you.
Yes.
And Father God, we give you the glory. We give you the honor. And we give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I'd like to use for a subject this morning, being unified in Jesus Christ. Being unified in Jesus Christ. Here in our text today, we find the Apostle Paul writing a letter to a particular church in Ephesus. And Paul wants to emphasize that our salvation is not just for our benefit, but God saved us to bring glory and honor to him.
Amen.
Everything God does is about him.
Yes.
It's his right. It's his privilege. It's his entitlement. His will. It is his purpose. And just as God had reconciled these believers in Ephesus, God has reconciled us together in hearts that we may be unified, so that God may be glorified in heaven through us here on planet Earth.
Amen.
Paul is writing to this church from prison. Now, if you do a good exegesis on this text, you will find that Paul did not murder anyone. He did not rob anyone. He was simply being obedient to God. And the devil started working through unsaved, callous, carnal people, and Paul ended up in prison.
Amen.
But if you notice in verse 1, Paul does not say that he's in prison of the Roman authorities. He says, I therefore the prisoner of the Lord.
Amen.
And what he wants us to understand is there's nothing that can happen to you on this earth unless God allowed it to happen.
Amen.
There was no way he could go to prison unless God allowed him to go to prison.
Yeah.
And there's nothing that can happen on this earth to us without God's permission.
Amen.
Some of you this morning are in your own prisons today. Some of you are in a prison of loneliness today. There's some people here that are in a prison of unemployment this morning. Some of you have been unemployed or underemployed for quite some time, and you wonder where God is. Some of you are in a prison of indebtedness, and you got bills, 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 and you don't know what you're going to do. You can barely make ends meet. Some of you are in a prison of illness, and you've been sick for quite some time. This hurts, and that hurts. This test is bad, and that test is bad. And it seems like this has been going on for quite some time. There's somebody here that may even be in a prison of doubt. You don't even know if God really exists. You don't even know if God really understands what you're going through. But I'm here to tell you today that God cares. And God knows. And He knows what you have need of even before you ask. Amen. And for those of you in prison, Paul has a solution. Amen. And he says to walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. Yes. Paul is in prison, yes, but he's still spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Yes. Paul understood that he had a ministry. And there was nothing going to stop him from fulfilling that ministry. And if you are saved, Paul is saying that you have a ministry. Yeah. And you need to throw yourself into your ministry. Yeah. I hear people say that when I get sad, I throw myself into my work. So I don't have time to think about my problems. I don't have time to think about my worries. Well, Paul is saying, throw yourself into your ministry. Yeah. And he tells us that we need to walk worthy. Yeah. To walk means to move forward. Yeah. It means to advance. Yeah. It means to grow. It means to consistently strive in your vocation. Paul is telling us, yeah, that all of us have a ministry. Yeah. All of us have a calling. And that is to help the body of Christ. Amen. To spread the good news, to win souls to Jesus. Yes. Paul said, if you are a baptized believer in Christ Jesus, you are called. You weren't called to be a pew marker. You are called into the ministry. Yes. Now when you go down to verse 11, Paul says that some are called to be apostles. Some are called to be prophets. Some are called to be pastors, teachers, and evangelists. But the key word here is some, not all. Some of you were called to counsel. I believe that some of you would be great marriage counselors. I believe that some of you would be great financial advisors. Some of you are really good with your hands in terms of plumbing and carpentry kind of work. There's some of you that will be great businessmen and great businesswomen. Some of you will even be great writers and school teachers. Yeah. God has a calling for you. Yeah. And every calling that God gives us is to bring glory and honor to Him down here. Yeah. God is calling us to help people. There's people here that have come here from prison. And I believe there's some of you that would be really good at helping those kind of people write a resume, get a job, and get back on the right track. Yes. Paul was saying, church, we need to get busy. Yes. Church, we need to get busy. Time is running out. Yes. So he says in verse 1, Paul says to walk worthy, that is to move forward. But he also tells us to be worthy. That means to be grateful for our own vacation or our own calling. I should never want to be like Reverend so-and-so. I should never want to preach or teach like someone else. I can admire someone else, but I must strive to be the best that I can be. And Paul wants you to strive to be the best that you can be in the vocation. vocation for which you were called.
Yes.
Now Paul says in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 11, he says, for I have learned. In other words, it didn't happen overnight. Yes. He says, for I have learned to be content in whatsoever state that I am in. It doesn't mean that you can't try to prove your situation. It doesn't mean that you should stop praying. It doesn't mean that you should stop seeking the face of God. But it does mean don't let your problems, don't let your setback stop you from living for God.
Amen.
So he says to walk worthy. Church, you need to hold your head up.
Amen.
And go forward.
Amen.
Not only should you do it, but God is the man. Now, in verse 2, Paul tells us, in order to walk worthy, he tells us that we need to have the right attitude.
Yes.
Over in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 1, the Apostle Paul says, be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. Now, some translations may say imitators of God. It's a picture. Some of you, when you were children, were real close to a parent, or you were real close to a grandparent. And when you went to that grandparent's house, she taught you how to make homemade bread. She taught you how to make cakes and pies and rolls and how to cut those apples. When you were a little girl, she put you in that stool and she taught you how to do these things, and you're so good at it today. Some of you, when you were little, your grandfather used to show you how to throw a baseball, or he taught you how to go fishing, and he taught you all these different things, and you're very good at it now because you were imitating that person. That's the same thing right here. We need to have that kind of relationship with God. So he says, be imitators or followers of God. If I am an imitator of God, I will reflect God's nature and God's distinction through my life here on planet Earth. If I'm an imitator of God. If I am an imitator of God, I'm going to have a kind spirit. If I'm an imitator of God, I'm going to have a forgiving spirit. And that's why Paul tells us to be ye kind one to another. There's no reason for me to come to church as a Christian and speak to one person and don't speak to the other. The Bible says we are all joints and ligaments in the body of Christ. Think if your blood vessels got mad at your heart, and your heart was pumping blood, and your blood vessels won't carry the oxygenated blood to the rest of your body, and your blood vessels won't carry the dirty blood back to your heart to be cleansed again, you would die. And that's what happens in the church. We spiritually die when we don't do what we're supposed to do. We're joints and ligaments in the body of Christ. He says, forgiving one another as Christ has forgiven us. Paul is saying that we need to learn how to resolve our conflicts among each other.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Sometimes we're going to rub each other the wrong way.
Yeah.
But we have to learn how to resolve our conflicts.
Yeah.
Now he says in verse 2, he's talking about attitude here. He says, with all lowliness. Lowliness means in humility. It means freedom from pride. In order to serve God, nothing is too low. Nothing is too mean.
Yeah.
If the toilets need to be cleaned, they need to be cleaned.
Yeah.
If the foyer needs to be painted, it needs to be painted.
Yeah.
If the grass needs to be cut, the grass needs to be cut.
Yeah.
The other day I came in to cut the grass.
Yeah.
And when I got here, Mike came up,
yeah,
and I said, thank you, Jesus. I had worked the night before, and I was so tired. But Mike came and cut the grass.
Yeah.
But cutting the grass is not too menial for me to do.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
We need to be humble and not prideful.
Yeah.
We need to be humble and not arrogant.
Right.
So he says that we need to walk in lowliness and in meekness. Now I want to talk a little bit about meekness. Because meekness don't mean weakness. Meekness means to be humbly patient, even when someone is provoking. Sometimes people will rub you the wrong way. Sometimes people will say stuff to embarrass you or to humiliate you. But Paul is saying that we don't get on their level. He's saying that if we're going to be imitators of God, Paul is saying that we must take the high road.
Amen.
But we need to learn how to resolve our conflicts. Now Jesus said, if you have aught against your brother, that you need to go to your brother.
Yes.
But I'm going to add on that you need to be prayed up when you go to your brother.
Yes.
You don't want to go to your brother when you're angry.
Yes.
And teed off. You need to cool down.
Yes.
And you need to spend some time in the presence of
yes.
God.
Yes.
And